wisely when we say something to somebody, and be careful. So anyway, going back to my point of Iblis and Musa alayhi salam. So Musa alayhi salam prays, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, okay, I'll give you another chance. And keep a note of the words that I'm using here, it's very important. And I'm going to ask you a question at the end. All of you in the class. So Allah says to Musa alayhi salam, tell him that if he obeys one command, he'll be forgiven. Now, all of you sitting in front of me, do you know why Iblis was cursed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? You know? What was it? Tell me loudly, please.
He didn't bow down to Adam.
He didn't bow. He didn't prostrate. Not bow. He didn't prostrate. He didn't do sajda to Adam. Because he said, I'm better than Adam. Adam is from mud and clay, and I'm from fire. Why should I prostrate in front of this person? And Allah had cursed him and said, you know, banished him away from the Garden of Eden, or whatever it was called, the paradise at that time. So Allah said that, okay, if he obeys one command now, I'll forgive him. No problem at all. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to Musa alayhi salam, go and tell him to prostrate on the grave of Adam. Now, in the first time, let's say, given the benefit of doubt, that he did not know what it was all about. He did not understand that this was Allah's command, it was not about Adam. At least now he knows. Now he knows that it's Allah's command, so when Musa alayhi salam goes and tells Iblis, this is what you need to do, and it'll be all sorted. No problem at all. And Iblis got very angry. He got very angry. He said, when Adam was alive, I did not prostrate in front of him. And you think I'm going to prostrate in front of a dead person's grave? I'm never going to do that. He again missed the point, didn't he? It was never about Adam. It was never about Adam. It was always about listening to Allah's command. And if you listen to Allah's command, things work out. Otherwise, you're banished. And you feel the wrath of Allah. So he didn't understand that. And he was not able to repent. So the point made was again, that when you are angry, and when you are full of yourself, you can lose it. So what he said to Musa alayhi salam was in this manner. He said, now that you have done some favor for me, you interceded for me with your Lord, you have a right on me, so I'll give you some advice. Now, look at him, how when he gets angry, how he changes. In the beginning, when he had met Musa, he said that, you know what, Musa, ask my Lord, he will give me another chance to repent. When he's angry now, he says, now that you have interceded for me with your Lord, doesn't say my Lord anymore. See the difference? This is what we do when we get angry, when we have arrogance within us. Iblis was always full of arrogance. And when he got angry, he changed from my Lord to your Lord, like as in Musa's Lord. So he said, you have some rights on me, I'll give you a piece of advice. Musa alayhi salam said, okay. He said, watch out for me in three situations and you will be safe. Make a note, brothers and sisters. He said, watch out for me in three situations and you will be safe. One is when you're angry. When you're angry, then remember that I am there. And if you remember that, then you will be safe, because then you lose your anger. Because none of us sitting here actually want to be a party of shaitan, do we? Do we? Yes or no?
No.
No? Salawat ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. So, when we are angry, we've got to remember that shaitan is into us. And that's when we need to be calm and let go. Let go of the situation. If you're standing, it is said you should sit down. If you're sitting down, you said lie down. So, you know, what you're trying to say is that calm down your body language. Don't give a chance for your body to react in a way. And don't speak. Zip it up. Once you zip up, a lot of things can actually, you know, go by. Don't speak at the time of anger. Let it go. Give it 5 minutes, 10 minutes, 1 hour if need be. I can challenge anybody to keep quiet for 1 hour. They'll struggle. 5 minutes, 10 minutes, inshallah, we can all do it. And then let it pass, that anger, and then react. Then act on it. And think about why you're angry, how we should be dealing with this, and all that. That's the first thing. He said, first situation is when you're angry, remember that I'm there. Second situation, he said, was when there's a battle, when you have to go to fight, then I'll come to you. And I'll show you that, you know, I'll remind you of your family. I'll remind you of your children. I'll remind you of the good life that you have. So that, you know, you feel fear and then you don't go out to the righteous path. That's the second time you've got to remember that I am there. And if something is right and you feel the need to, you know, things are talking to you and you feel that, you know, you're being reminded of your children and your family and all that, you know that I'm there. So be careful of that situation. And the third situation was, don't sit alone with a non-matter. Anytime you sit alone with a non-matter, remember that I'm the third person there. And that could lead to some sin or the other. Somewhere or the other. You know what a non-matter is? Yeah? The young boys, some of them don't know. So I should explain. A non-matter is somebody who you're not supposed to sit with, of the opposite gender, who you're not supposed to sit with without hijab or alone. So, for example, boys, they can sit with their mother, their sister, their auntie, their mother-in-law. All these are okay. The rest, all are non-matter. So you got to keep away if you're in a room with them alone. You should not sit with them alone. So this is where shaitan is. So these are three situations. Shaitan is giving an advice to Musa alayhi salam, who's one of the greatest prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it is good advice, I must say. It is very good advice. It's not about who is giving it. We should look at what the matter is, what the subject matter is, what the advice is all about. So it is good advice, and we should all try to implement this in our life, especially the grown-ups who tend to get angry at younger people sometimes. And, you know, sometimes we feel fear when we have to do the right thing sometimes. And you remember that shaitan might be around, and we do du'as and all that. And it's a process. It doesn't happen in one day. But it's a process. We keep working on it. And ultimately, we'll be in a good position when the crux of the matter comes at a certain time, inshallah. Salawat ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad.
Another interesting story about Iblis was when he managed to present himself in front of a monk. And the monk asked him, he recognized him, the pious man. So he recognized Iblis, who is the shaitan. And said, what is the time when it's the most easy for you to deal with or to sway the human being? And he said, Iblis said, that it's the time when you are angry. He said, when you are angry, it's like me having you, like a child has a ball. Child can play with the ball, throw it around here, there and everywhere. And Iblis says that when somebody's angry, this is how I feel. He's like a ball in my hand, like a toy. I can play with it. So we have got to be very, very careful, my dear brothers and sisters, about anger. Anger is walaikum assalam. Anger is something that is a very, very dangerous thing to lose. If we lose our cool, and we tend to lose our cool, then we've got to do some anger management for sure. Some way of it, some dua, some amal, some psychologist, whatever is needed to be done. If you see that there's an anger situation in ourselves, we've got to manage it somehow or the other. It takes time, but as long as we're sincere in it, we should be able to overcome it, inshallah. Another gate for shaitan to come into us is when we are focused on beautifying ourselves and our things. So when we say beautifying ourselves and our things, you know, talking about always interested in new clothes, always new shoes, new handbags, need to change the curtains of the house very regularly, need to get a new furniture all the time. You know, always trying to be, you know, ahead of the game, kind of. And we are focused on this. Once we are focused on these kind of things, shaitan actually doesn't need to do much. He's already won. Two reasons. One is that we don't have time to do anything else. We are focused on these things. We don't have time to pray. And even if we pray, it's just like a job, you know. Finish, go quickly again to what we need to do. We need to get new something. And we don't have focus on the real matters. We lose focus on our Lord. We lose focus on reflecting on things. And reflection is a big virtue, you know. When we know something and then we reflect on it, then there's a way to act on it. If we don't reflect on what we learn, tomorrow we're going to forget. So revise and reflect on what we've learned. And the second reason why shaitan doesn't need to act is because people in society will always have a fight with you about that. They'll be jealous. Somebody or the other is going to be jealous. Somebody or the other will be rubbed wrong by that person who, you know, who's trying to be above society or trying to be beautifying or, you know, ordaining themselves with all kinds of glorious little things. And people feel jealous and they attack that person. And there'll be fights. And there'll be arguments. And there'll be bad relationships. Shaitan's job is done, he doesn't need to do anything else. So he lays more eggs. It's like Shaitan gives you suggestions. Shaitan's suggestions are like the eggs of a hen. They keep hatching. They keep growing. They keep growing. So we've got to be very, very careful. We've got to have a sense of contentment. If we have contentment, my dear brothers and sisters, we're the richest people in the whole world. I tell you why. If I am happy with the kind of shoe and clothes I'm wearing, I don't need anything more. Then whatever money I have, I won't need that much. I will give it away or I'll store it somewhere for good use or something like that. But the point I'm trying to make is that I'm not poor anymore. The person who is poor is not somebody who doesn't have things. The person who is poor is the one who keeps wanting things. Because he doesn't have it. Even though he has it, he doesn't feel that he has it. And that's the person who's poor. And that's the one we should be very pitiful for. Because you see that person having a lot of things that Allah has given through His grace, but he doesn't feel that he owns so much, he has been given so much. And he's always hankering for more. And that is a tragic situation. Because that person, if he's hankering for more all the time, he'll never have enough. He'll keep hankering for more. He'll become a millionaire and a billionaire, but he'll still hanker for more for himself. Again, I want to emphasize here that it's not a bad thing to make a good living, to earn more money, or whatever wealth you are accumulating in whatever job you're doing. You earn for yourself and your family members. You work hard for yourself and your family members. Once your needs are fulfilled, share that wealth with everyone. The satisfaction you get and the happiness you'll feel is going to be unbelievable. And you know, like I said the other day as well, when we do something good, we do a charitable act, we feel like, you know what, we own the world now, we've done a great job. We all feel like you're really walking on air, so happy you've done a good deed. We all feel good when we do good deeds. And it is good to feel happy when you do good deeds, but not proud. So the happiness we get when giving away without expecting anything is a wonderful feeling. We should all inculcate into ourselves this habit of giving away to people from whom we don't expect it. And we should inculcate in our children this habit as well, to give away our good stuff, not our bad stuff. You know, giving away bad stuff is no great thing. Everybody gives away bad stuff. So children, you can tell your children whatever you want them to do, that's fine, it's a good thing to do. But if they don't see you doing it, it'll not happen. There'll be a dichotomy in your action and your word. And that is where hypocrisy comes in. And we've got to be very, very careful of that. Salawat ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. We will change our language. A loud salawat for hours of Muhammad Zaman.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
Jazakallah brother Salat. Thank you very much for being here and sorting this out. There's another big gate that I want to discuss, and after that we'll go towards a conclusion. One of the biggest gates we have is overeating. Overeating is something that Shaitan enjoys. The money might be halal, the food might be halal. It is your food, your right, you bought it, or everything as per Islamic rules. But if you overeat, that's a big gate for Shaitan. What it does is it increases our appetite. You know, it increases our desires. And when our desires are on a higher level, less chance of us being aware of God. Our God consciousness, our taqwa will go down. You know, our needs are basic, but we tend to feed ourselves a bit more than what we need. And that's when we have problems. Like, you take a note yourself, it's very simple. All I'm telling in my lectures, these are very, very basic, simple things. I'm just reminding myself, basically. And if we overeat, for example, we have a nice, delicious food cooked at home, we go and really enjoy the food and have a good, you know, portion of it. After that, you feel tired. Oh my God, can't move now. Isn't it? Happens many times. So delicious food, you can't move now. So then what happens? Time for salat comes. You do it later. have a little bit of a nap, then we'll do it later. This is shaitan. This is basic principle of shaitan all over again. You know,